like to welcome, we have three city council members with us today. Thank you. I wasn't expecting Jerry, but it's always a pleasure. So, Jerry Orlans, thank you for coming. We appreciate your time. We were talking earlier this Sunday afternoon at 5 o'clock, which I'm sure we would all rather be doing something else. So, anyways, Nancy Diamond, thank you for coming. Appreciate your time today. And Kent Igleheart, which I always want to put an N in your name, and I'm so sorry. but thank you. You've heard worse, me too. So anyways, thank you three very much for coming. What I'd like, and I've talked to the council members about this, is to provide an introduction. I think many of us are aware of what the UDC is and how it's affecting the city of Roswell, but many of us don't know what's happening today, where we are. So if they could provide us with an introduction, perhaps an overview of some recent developments, and Where's the end? What are we working towards?
That's a great question.
So, if that's not the question of the hour, right? But also as residents and homeowners, you know, we have a big investment in this community and we want to make sure that we protect our interests. So perhaps some thoughts there as well. So without further ado, I think Jerry's going to observe, but I welcome Nancy and Kent to come and talk to us. So with that in mind, Nancy, would you like to start us off?
Do you want to? It's up to you.
I can kind of give you the background on it.
Thank you
for having us. For the last year and a half, anytime we could get in front of an audience to talk about the code, we did it. There aren't a lot of people dying to hear about zoning code, so we appreciate that you're here. Step back just a little bit to kind of give you how we got here. As you know, about 2009, 2007, really, when the economic downturn really began to be real to a lot of us, we recognized at the city that this was an opportunity to kind of regroup and get our house in order. So the last 4 years, 5 years, we've spent getting organized and kind of taking stock of the growth that's happened in Roswell, which was really rapid from the 80s and 90s, and how we're going to handle that going forward and what that's going to look like. Our zoning code at that point was built on greenfield development, which we don't have a lot of anymore. There were a lot of parts to it that had been piecemeal changed over the years to fit what we needed, and one of the council members in Alpharetta described theirs as a bag of hangers, and that's the closest I can come to it. It felt like that. It was just, you know, it was hard to get your hands on. You might think you saw all of it in one piece and then you'd come back. We heard it a lot from people trying to do business. I did everything they said and then I got this far down the process and they came up with something else. And that was a problem for staff and for the public. And if the staff has trouble with it, then you know, what chance do the rest of us have? So we've gone through a number of processes to kind of get organized and take stock. And the first thing was the comprehensive plan in 2010. And we're required by the state to do that every 5 years, largely so that we don't, as a state, end up bailing out small or other cities who don't plan. So that, you know, it's not so much the city telling us what to do as making sure that we are planning for our future and our money, our infrastructure, our zoning, across the board kind of things. So we spent 2 years having a public conversation about what do we want in Roswell? How do we see it happening? And there's a lot of similarities and a few differences, but we spent a long time not just doing the document to fill the state requirement, but really putting in the time to say, what do we want for Roswell? How do we see it growing? We know there's going to be people coming. How is that going to be handled? We know there's going to be development. What kind and how do we want it to look? And once we did that, then we said, okay, how do we make sure that it stays the way we want it to be or goes the way we want it to be? So we did a strategic economic development plan. What's feasible? You know, we can say we'd love for everything to be a park, but financially we know that's not realistic. But how does it work? How can we make that? So from that, we, along with that process, we basically outsourced our economic development to Roswell Inc., which you may have heard of. It's a public-private partnership. So we started kind of getting that house in order. And then on the zoning side, everything we saw was your zoning code is not going to get you where you want to go. It's not going to allow you to have the housing you want to have. And the biggest pressure that we see, you know, there is a workforce housing concern. I'm not sure we have a shortage, but that's something we're talking about. and we also need someplace for our empty nesters to go. We have a lot of people who bought houses here, brand new, built houses, and now they don't want to live in the big house anymore. I'm one of them. We sold our big house and we just discovered quickly there's nothing there to buy much. I mean, you really have to fight for it, and as you've seen, most of them don't even go on the market now. So that was a focus, is different housing types, not so much different prices, but different sizes. And so as we went through talking about how that looks, we created a number of different categories, and I'm sure Kent will talk about some of how that has evolved, but I think I have this map that will show you one of the flaws in our plan as we've seen it, and we get to do this all over again next year. This is a map of the city in our comprehensive plan. Everything in blue is it upside down? Sorry. It's not a shape that's real, you know, distinctive. So everything in blue is suburban residential. So that's what we're calling suburban residential. There are on here places like Arnold Mill, Hartsgravel, King Road, Crabapple, Woodstock Road, that don't account for anything other than suburban residential. And to me, this is a flaw that we need to work on, and that will come as part of our process. But as we went through there, we said, how do we want housing to fit into these categories? We have corridors and nodes, what we call. This is basically Holcomb Bridge and Highway 9. And so we talked about the zoning code accounts for how we do development downtown, which is the historic district, basically, and around these big corridors and nodes. We really haven't been as specific in our comprehensive plan on how that residential suburban looks. And as such, we've been searching for the categories that we will put for housing in those areas. And one of the controversies has been, how small do you allow lots to be in suburban residential? Our comp plan says that we want to have new cottage housing in suburban residential, new open space parks, and new mixed use. Now, that's not going to fit everywhere. That's not going to fit next to Brookfield. But there are places closer to those corridors and nodes where it probably will. Unfortunately, they're all suburban residential at this point. And it's interesting, I think there's two conversations on Chafin that have evolved through some of these conversations. The one that I'm thinking you may have heard from Jim Paris, and I'm not sure if that's who came and spoke to you, he's looking at, I think, 6 acres. It's close to Crabapple, and he lives on that property, and he's got around him some smaller ranch houses, largely widows living around him, and he comes from North Carolina, where they've been very successful doing these cottage courts, and they take very small units compared to what we're used to living in, and they make double use of everything. For instance, you know, one of the things that caught my eye when he was doing it, the pantry will have a revolving thing so that there will be, you'll make the most of that space and how you really optimize that space. And these are homes that sell for, on the average, about $100 a square foot more than your traditional single family home. So his vision was to have those people around him would like to be in their neighborhood, but they don't want the big yard anymore. They don't want as much house. So his vision was to put a cottage court kind of a thing in the middle of his property. I think somehow in the conversation, there's been a concern that the Wexford, across from Wexford, that big corner at Hartsgravel and Chafin is somehow going to be one big cottage court. And I've not seen anything or heard anything about that. It's not something they couldn't apply for. Right now, they could apply for townhouses on that whole piece of property.
That's how it's currently zoned.
Yeah. Well, it's not, no, it's zoned for agriculture, I'm guessing. I don't know, I haven't looked at it, but you know, if they came in tomorrow and said, we're zoned agriculture, reasonably, that's probably not a fair use for them. They probably could do more than that. We had one up on Etrus. They asked for what they call R3A, which is basically 9,000 square foot lots. And we said, no, that's too intense. We'll give you R1, which we feel like is fair compared to where you are. And after that, they got with the neighborhood and said, you know, we'll do higher quality and we'll do some things back here for your stormwater if you'll let us have R2 on the interior. And we went along with that. But by and large,
Is that an interest in Kent?
Yes.
That development
yes.
Went in?
And we've also learned some lessons on that. There's some things that are important to know. Like in their case, we had a buffer that we asked for. And when the stormwater requirements came in, that spilled over into the buffer. That will not happen in the new code. That is a specific, that the buffer will be the buffer and the stormwater will have to be on top of that. So anyway, I go off on tangents because it's 300 pages and it goes in all directions. But I guess my message to you is, it's really not different than it is today, in that we could, like I said, we could put townhomes in any of these places today, but we don't. And you know, could a future council do it? Yeah, a future council could do anything, but we all live here. We all answer to each other. And you know, you've seen in a homeowner association that not everybody always agrees, and there's always six sides to the story. But I have not seen any, in fact, I had a call just on the way over here from somebody who wanted to put townhouses on the spot. And I said, I'm very careful not to speak for my other fellow council members, but I don't see that. I would have a hard time doing that. And I've said that more than once. You know, I know it doesn't look like we turn down a lot, but a lot of them never get out of the block. So I think that's important to remember. And we do answer to you. We are not somebody that you won't see at the grocery store. I go to this Publix or King Road. I'm pretty sure Jerry probably does too. We're living where he does. And we're not looking to densify Roswell, but we are looking to provide empty nester housing that we don't have now. And I mean, my pastor left for Milton because they didn't have a place to move to. So that's really our goal. Linda.
I was just wondering, is there any standard protocol that exists or is being considered in UDC for maintaining and in, increasing or enhancing green space?
Yes, actually,
if an organization has 10 acres, is there X amount that has to be set aside for green space?
Yes, and that's something we've added to this code over what we had before. And in particular, if, you know, especially like we focused on the townhouses and stuff, but once you get into the R2 and above, they're kind of spread out already. You know, we try with the buffers.
I'm thinking of it when there is that increased density.
Yes.
What is their offset then?
They're required, in addition to the buffers and setbacks, a 20% landscaped space. And we've gone back and forth on what that means. Technically, they could make that a hardscape under what we have, and it's a little hard, like if it was a fountain or you know, a courtyard, but they also have a tree requirement and recompense. So, you know, there's a lot. I'm dealing with one of your neighbors who's actually developing a property between Forest and Myrtle, and I don't know how many of you have even gone down that way, but it's across from Mount Zion, it's down from the library, mm-hmm. and it's very cool. It's going to be beautiful, but they are challenged to do. They're going to do a few little townhomes and a few little single family. I believe they're starting in the fours, and they're going to do a park space in the middle. So, you know, I think the focus clearly in everything we've said and done is that we want that. And I think that's been a lot of what we haven't done before. We've said, you can't do this, you can't do that, but we haven't telegraphed what we do want. And that's really the focus in this. It's not as much what don't do, but what can you do.
Can I just clarify, because I want to make sure I heard properly. So are you saying that hardscaping was considered to be green space under the formula?
There's not a green, it's not considered green space, it's considered landscape space.
Oh,
and you know, now realistically, there are also requirements under our environmental guidelines where you have to have, you can only have so much of a percentage of pervious surface. And I know I just built a house in that park east next to Crabapple Middle School, and it was very difficult to meet that with a small lot. You really have to take every inch you can, so there's really not a lot of interest in putting hardscaping. It's expensive and it's not easy to do with the ratios. They actually insisted that we put a little verge, which is a term I didn't know, that little green space in your driveway, which my husband absolutely hates, but it helped get them to the square footage. That's how close we were. And I'm in, my footprint is 1,800 square feet with a garage. So it's difficult to get there, but anything over 10 units in a group has to have a certain amount of common space and a certain amount of common parking in addition to whatever open space and landscape that we include. So, and some of it is based on which area and how it meets up to the other ones, you know, what it both meets up to and how that's treated. You know, but residential to residential looks a little different than industrial next to industrial.
It is. I have one other question. I've read a lot on it and everything else, and there's certainly been very clear alarms about the UDC moving forward, and that the template of the UDC actually increasing development and density in Roswell. Mm-hmm. But I'm hearing you say that technically the propensity for that density already exists.
Yes.
Because it could be rezoned at any time with
yes.
approval of city council.
Yeah, I mean,
the UDC will give them, a consistent roadway for
The UDC gives you options. It doesn't mean that any one of those is appropriate for any one spot, but you know, when townhouses are available now, to me, Arce 4,000 square foot and 6,000 square foot lots are not that big a jump. We have that, and so the cottage court and the smaller lots are, to me, in between that and the single family housing. Any apartments would be conditional, which means they'd have to come through our process, and I can tell you, I had a call about that this week. Oh, I have this place and I'm thinking we'll do 300 apartments. I said, think again. You know, until we see things, we just don't have that need right now. We're already redeveloping Fraser Street. That's coming along. That's going to be 320 units. It's not a quite pound for pound increase in units from increase in bedrooms from what Fraser Street has. It's more one bedrooms than two. But it is definitely going to be a more compact, and it is going to be much more expensive. I've also heard that part of the goal for that area at Hardscrabble and Chaffin is to put low-income housing. And I will tell you, in all the discussion about our need for low-income workforce housing, which again, we need to demonstrate before we do, the consistent issue is not zoning, it's cost. There's just, the land is too expensive here. Habitat doesn't build here anymore because they can't find property. They've gone into a renovation mode in Roswell, so they have a totally different model here. Does that make any sense? I'll let, I know Kent has feelings on that as well, so I will let him tell you his thoughts.
And I guess that's why I was asked to come, because we do have slightly different perspectives on some things. But before we get to that, I do want to say, I think we all should give Nancy a lot of credit, because she spent, I don't even know how many hours over many years putting all this together and really making that go forward. And many of us spend many hours, but she's been the one to spend the most and do all the extra work and all the extra meetings and that. So that deserves a lot of credit, because it takes a lot to do that. And actually, you know, we agree probably on most. And I think that the UDC is a good concept overall, and it helps us, will help us do a lot of redevelopment in areas we need it. It does give more options, makes things more clear about how our zoning code works, easier to follow through. So all those things are good. I do have a slightly different perspective on the density side, because right now we do have caps on density of what they can be. So townhome, we do have some on the ground in the city that are up to 8 units per acre. That's in the past, we've capped that, we don't allow that anymore. Right now, our maximum allowed in townhomes is 5 per acre. The UDC essentially removes density as a specific number, and it's based on how many, you know, what our green space is, what the parking requirement is, what the stormwater requirements are, and all those are elements that depend on the site. And then basically whatever you can put in with the minimum size of that particular building. I've calculated, we may see different, I think that it can get between 10 and 15 townhomes on a single acre. And when you're on a smaller property, of course, that doesn't work as well, because it takes more to get into, you know, 1 acre or even a half acre. But once you start moving into larger pieces, you have more flexibility. And I think you can get up to the 10 to 15 units per acre, which to me is a substantial increase over 5 or even the 8 that's there now. Cottage courts, I think, is a good thing. It has the, I think probably everybody knows the basics of it. It looks like a little horsehoe, and the houses surround a central courtyard, all good things. That is, again, substantially higher than what's there now. And that's just my overall concern, that there are elements that do increase that ultimate number of houses that are in places. A lot of places that won't matter, but I am concerned where, like the Chaffin, example and Hembry on the other side. And hearing Jim and some of their neighbors, I've heard them mention 20 acres within there. And when you start putting those in that big an area, those numbers tend to go much higher, I think. And those are my concerns. And then ultimately, obviously, that has impacts on roads. And if it's empty nesters, it probably won't impact schools as much. But there are a lot of other elements that come through that. And once you open that on one place, the folks next to them tend to say, well, they've got it, so we want to get it as well. So, I mean, we've seen that in other places. So, again, I think there are huge, great things with the UDC. And when it focuses on the corridors and the areas that we all think we need to redevelop that are the empty shopping centers and all those kind of things, all that's, I think, appropriate. But my concern is when it spreads out to others. And I think there is truth to we need some other forms of housing available. But it really matters where it goes. And that's kind of where we are now. Well, what is that point? I've proposed or tried to get us to look at it being more limited. Right now it's more open and certainly there's, and I'm saying Jerry will agree, it will come down to somebody makes a proposal. Everybody's involved in the process as it is today, and the council will ultimately decide what that is. But my concern is when you have a parameter that's here, that's what we're working within as opposed to the parameter that's here. So that's where we are in my perspective. So again, I think generally we're on the same page on most elements. I am more concerned about some of the what I think are the ultimate impacts of those things. And I wouldn't say that you're not concerned about them. I make that clear. I just think, you know, I am concerned that we're not necessarily dealing with some of that or not being as careful.
The reason we're specifically concerned here today is because of this issue of achievement. And the people we've talked to in the neighborhoods that are closer than ours are talking about 20-acre development for someone who's bringing pedestrian to achievement. And, you know, the idea of cottage for my parents live in the community like that, it's beautiful, it's much more expensive than my home. I mean, it's really nice. And I don't get the impression that that's what is planned. I think the email that we saw last, mixed use, that's a transitional area. I don't really consider that to be a transitional area right there. It's totally residential on this side of the school. So I guess, what do y'all know about the specifics of what someone is trying to put in play there? And what are they specifically trying to put in the UDC? Why is it important they get those folks in the UDC? Does that make sense?
And yes, and Nancy may have more detail on that, but I've basically heard the same things you have. The folks who own the property, cottage courts have been their primary description of things, but some of the things that he's shown of examples have much more than that. So, and what exactly, that's one of that's one of the issues here when you talk about what does Canton Street mean to some people. And the mayor and I have had this discussion where he thinks of it as the portion that's the two stories with the, you know, the all hardscapes. I think of it as the entire stretch that includes the individual homes that are now restaurants and things further, that has a lot of green space. So if you're in this part of it, that means one thing. If it's the rest of it, that means something else. And so I don't know that we all have the same perception as what those are. And is, you know, walkability is important, but what does that mean in different places? So I don't think they really know. I don't know if we could even say.
Yeah, I've not seen anything about mixed use on Chafin in any way. I mean, I've not heard Jim say that, and I hear Jim a lot. Jim has and I have spent a lot of time together, and he's very well versed on what. But he's always been focused strictly on the empty nester housing. Now he does believe that the long-term future of Crabapple could be more of a walkable from that property, and he sees, you know, what you have at Crabapple and Crossville. You know, you have the church on the other side as you get to Chafin, and you've got some things that could potentially be a small grocery store or coffee shop or something. And I think we're a ways from that. I think we're a ways from that, and, you know, two blocks over from Hampshire.
The traffic situation there, I mean, I'm not really sure a lot of cars travel from Chafin here to Roswell, and there are many warnings. Right. Wait and wait down people on both sides, and, you know, okay, and they let me out. So the idea of that much density right there, I mean, the road would have to be, there would have to be a lot there. I mean, that's a significant change.
It's actually from Hard Scrabble, it's about two-thirds of the way to Crabapple. And you don't even see it. It goes back. He lives on, I was thinking, I didn't think it was 20, but it's possible that all those guys, yeah, because all those folks together.
No.
No, it's down across from Ivy Mill. It's almost to Crabapple.
Church.
Yeah. We've got Crabapple going north-south, and then Chafin coming off of that. It's kind of in between there. And then Hembry is the other border on that side, and it goes in between those two spots.
So it's near the intersection of
Crabapple.
So it's not Arce travel. So
right.
It's near the church.
Right.
Yes.
But
closer.
To Ken's point about when you do it here and you do it there, so if you let them do that over there, then what prevents that piece of property on the corner of Arce travel and Chafin from going high density? See what I mean?
Like well, the same thing that Ken.
Yeah,
and I would say.
So I really view that as one issue that would accommodate that entire piece of property that goes from one corner all the way up. Do you see what I'm saying? Like, so I don't think we can. I think that's what Ken's saying. If we say we'll do this here, what does that mean for that other corner? Because that person is going to want to sell that property at some point in development as well.
Perhaps.
I think, yes, and I do think they will at some point. I'd love for them to look at parkland for parts of it, but that's another whole story that might create other traffic that we didn't want to talk about. But, you know, if tomorrow any of those were sold, because they're all older folks that live there, if any of those properties are sold, and we're finding this, what's happened is the family has sold most of the big farm, and there's a pretty good chunk of it left at the homestead, and those are starting to turn over. And you know, we look at, to me, hardscrabble is very different than crabapple. And I think you've got to look at what's directly around it. Oh, you okay? But I also think if you took that 20 acres that Jim has and you came in and said, you know, I'm in agriculture, I'm in the middle of Roswell, I need to be able to do something more, I can see as, you know, R1 is not an unreasonable thing there. And you can put a lot of homes, a lot of single family on pretty good sized lots in there. And now you've added families with kids and trips and stuff, whereas, and traffic hour, whereas if you put in empty nester, to me that's a better neighbor. But, and to the point of the buffers and those kind of things, I understand there are places where the numbers shift a little bit on the coverage of the lot. That is partially a factor of best practices in the industry and very largely a factor of what we've been doing in practice. You know, what we say in our code and what we've actually done over the years in a lot of places is very different. So you'll find property that's been varied and varied and varied, and they've got, you know, 25 variances and conditions on them. And I mean, just looking at the book of conditions on the property since 2000 is kind of overwhelming.
I forgot what it was called. Whatever rules exist to maintain the corridor along 92. That
Parkway Village.
Parkway Village.
Parkway Village.
Yeah, Parkway Village. Okay. That was a very hard stopping point. You will do it this way, and that's that.
Right.
And it's truly been one of the things that has maintained some incredible beauty in this area. Mm-hmm. Are there any hard stopping points in the UDC? I'm not getting the impression there are.
As far as property, well, I mean,
property development, increased density, are there hard stopping points? Are there points at which you, as a council, can say, nope, can't do that, no matter how much you plead?
Yeah, well, and I think what the discussion is, we have intent statements for each of the districts, Parkway Village, corridors and nodes, downtown, and suburban residential, and employment districts. If you look at what we have in the, what do we put in as intent statements for suburban residential? That's really what the question is. Do we let Cottage Court, S4, and S6 in there? Which S4 is 4,000 square foot, S6 is 6,000 square foot. Are those in there? And we've done this all around the comprehensive plan that was the two-year document that we all talked about, and that it's very clear that those are in there. That doesn't mean they go everywhere in there. And that goes back to when we do this comprehensive plan next year, because we did so much discussion this last time, we're in a great position to say, okay, let's talk about the mini corridors and nodes. Let's talk about Crabapple and Arnold Mill and Hardscrabble and Woodstock and maybe put that together. How do we see that? In addition to this, we're creating design guidelines for the whole city, which we've never had. And it's essentially like putting a Parkway Village kind of design concept on the city as a whole. that will be the factor, and I think we talked about the effective date of this. We're looking at a June 1st because the design guidelines will not be done probably till May, and we want that all to go together. So there will be that part of it. But I do believe that we need more discussion, and I don't see the council that I know doing anything drastic in the meantime. But, you know.
I understand the idea of the cottage court. When you say 4,000 or 6,000, can you give me an idea of what that means? Like, what do this one look like?
Well, R1, which is, I don't know what.
R1 is 30,000 square feet. R2 is 18,000 square feet.
No, wait.
A lot.
R1 is 18, R2 is 12.
The other
area? R2 is 12.
You are correct. 18, 12, 6 is half of that. There's a 9 in between there.
Which is what we've had before is R3A.
And 4,000.
Do you have any examples?
But what we haven't done, this is one of my concerns, we haven't translated that into density. So, you know, the density of 18,000 square feet is 3.23, I think is the exact number. When you get down to 4, clearly that is, you know, and this is one of the things we don't know. It depends on the site as to, you know, what the percentage of green space is, how much parking they need, all that kind of stuff. But I believe you can fit between, you know, around 8 per acre. The bigger the spot, I think the more you can get. But clearly, I think that's an increase. So, and my concern is once you start it, and this is, you know, whether we want to or not, once you start it, then the next one comes in and makes that argument, goes to court, and so on. And we don't have those options now.
Sure, if that gives you exactly, but I mean, I think about a lot of the houses in here are 4,000-ish square feet, and if you think about that, and the bottom of it's about 2, you're talking about twice the first floor of your house as a 4,000 square foot lot, and you know that it's little, it's definitely little, but you know, again, we're not putting it anywhere. Somebody's going to have to come in and say, this is so wonderful that you want to consider this. And we go through the same process we do. You know, R3A is 9,000 square feet. That's what they try to do at Kent and Etrus, which is closer to a lot more commercial than you are. And we just couldn't see it.
I think we all know what the John Whelan townhomes look like. Mm-hmm. So what would that be? Those are...
The ones that are right down all around the corner?
Across down by Home Depot.
Right. Honestly, I should have that number in my head, but I believe those are closer to 5 units per acre because that was the maximum at that time. I don't know exactly, but I'm guessing that that's the maximum because that's what it's been set.
So that density could be triple potentially?
Well, it depends. I wouldn't go triple, but I would say at least double. I think so.
Yeah, no, it is. But I mean, but that doesn't mean that's what we're going to do.
Yeah.
It also, but you know, down near Crabapple, off of where some of those shopping centers are, it might make sense. So, and we have some of that. If you look, there's townhomes and cluster homes all down around there, and that's where, you know, it's not intended for out in a field.
Is there any kind of wording in the UDC that says just because somebody else got it, you don't automatically?
Well, I'm legally, I think that's why they have us.
No.
They wouldn't need us if it was for them. Well, and that's where, you know, we have language in there that says when you go to do this, you can consider the infrastructure, the schools, you know, the water, the traffic. But you can't say, I think this will increase traffic because the courts have said that alone is not the issue. But if we can do a preponderance of it and focus back on our comprehensive plan, which is why that's so important that says what we want. And I think it came a long way from where we were, but it still needs some refining. So I don't see us making any sudden moves until that happens.
This is totally different, but I have to ask.
Sure.
Today we were longtime Roswell residents, love our town, love our neighborhood. We were going from City Hall. Go south on Atlanta Street, right before Sloan. On the left is
the yellow house.
There we go.
Okay.
Do we not have any codes for
good? interestingly enough, and Jerry
this
may
is one place the UDC will help.
This is a place that seniors. Okay, the situation is in 1988, we created a historic district, and Jerry can chime in anytime. We created a historic district, and with that, there's a state law that we use to do that. And in depending on which lawyer you ask, we do or do not have control over paint color and landscaping. Now, what happened for all those years up to recently is that our Historic Preservation Commission, our HPC, said, you will paint it this color. And people said, okay, and went on and did it. Well, what happened was, you know, somebody else came along and painted it something different, and they said, no, you will paint it this color. And they said, we don't have to. And turns out they might have been right. So we have been talking to our legislators. They are perfectly happy to help draft a bill to fix that, if that's the case. But there are some legal minds who think that we do have that right. So right now we have it in the state attorney general's office. Sam Orlans is looking at it, and he is supposed to tell us if we can in fact do that. And you know, if we can't, we'll work on fixing it. If we can, we'll go forth with that. But yes, it is.
But we did it for years and limiting it, and then all of a sudden we found out we really may not have the legal aspect to do that.
But the irony of it is that if you're not in the historic district, you have to go through the design review board, and they can tell you what to do. So there are actually more rules outside the historic district, which was never the intention. So we're working on it.
Some because there was less control historically.
Yeah, that's it.
So the meeting that's tomorrow night, that's a working meeting. Is the public invited to that, or is that?
Oh yeah, it is billed as the second reading of the UDC, which technically, if we vote one way or another, we could technically vote to finish it tomorrow night. I do not anticipate that happening. We've done work sessions last Monday, and yesterday we were there from 11 to 5 on Kent's birthday. He was a great sport about it. We had cake, but I don't think that did it.
And I thought it was like 5:30.
Yeah, was it? Maybe it was. I don't know. Anyway, it was all day. But we got a ton done, and hopefully everybody feels more comfortable going forward. But I don't feel like that's enough time for everybody to really get comfortable with everything that we talked about, and a lot of it's grammar and not big stuff, but there are some things that, you know, we need to have everybody make sure they're comfortable with. So unless something unforeseen happens, my thought is to go into Monday, present it as we see it coming down, basically as what the motion I intend to make, and then defer it for 2 weeks to the 24th. And then that should give everybody time to really dig in, and then at whatever time we pass it, it will have an effective date of either June 1st or when the design guidelines are done, whichever is later.
Could you share a little bit about those design guidelines? Mm-hmm. Like what is our design philosophy as possible? What are we trying to do?
Well, and I have, you know.
I know they're not done, so you may not.
No, they just actually, the first draft came out last week, and the HPC and the Historic Preservation and the Design Review Board worked together with the consultants to talk about how they wanted to see it. And they came through and kind of gave us an overview. And I'm sorry to tell you, I can't quote you stuff on that yet. The mayor moves us to different departments every 2 years. And as of 5 o'clock that day, Becky is now the community development liaison. And I'm in transportation. So I said, hey, design guidelines, I haven't had a chance to. But, you know, it's basically taking the things like the Parkway Village and the Historic District, and you know, how do we see the setbacks going? We have some that are up the street and some that are further back, and they've talked about making a zone, and that has a lot to do with the Parkway Village look, is, you know, how far back are things, and that fence, is that something you do, some kind of signature piece that runs through, or, you know, those kind of things are all gonna be part of the discussion. But that is, I believe it's online, if I'm not mistaken, the first draft is, so we'd love to have any input if anybody's interested.
When I have visitors from out of town, inevitably one of their first comments sometimes is how pretty it is along 92 in this section.
Yes.
And how not pretty it is when you first come off 400.
Yes.
So that's why that comes to mind when I think of some kind of a structure, something inherent that everybody has to follow.
And we would love that, but bear in mind it has to come with new development. We can't say, okay, now you have to change to do that. And that's kind of what's happened in Parkway Village. You know, it's filled in over time, but it's taken how many years?
That was passed in 92, or I think 92 was when Parkway Village was passed. It was done just before I got on council. I was on a committee that worked on that. And ever since, I've been trying to see how we could get it over the other side of town. But to retroactive something like that is almost impossible. Parkway Village was done because it was a two-lane road. It was new. Nothing had built on it. So we were able to get it done and get it in place that way.
But we do have some great designs for the new improvements to that interchange, 400 and Holcomb Bridge. So as that develops, that's going to be much more. I mean, we're very keenly aware that our gateway is ugly, and that is a priority. One of the cultural arts things that you're talking about, the cultural arts plan, it has a huge public art component, and that's a discussion. And just something that I didn't know all the history of before I got on council, so I always like to share. If you're going to the mall, say, and you get off at Mansell Road, you might notice they have those beautiful flagstones, stone on the exits, and they have more landscaping, and really all the way up to Forsyth County, those exits all do. That is done with a community improvement district. And those businesses along that corridor tax themselves an extra, I think, 3%. And it goes into a pot, and they do those improvements. And they leverage grant money and state money to do that. So it's something that we could do. We have to get to a point where that interchange, where the businesses in that area see the value to taxing themselves. But it is something that you'll probably hear more about in the future. And there's also a move to, the CID can move out from the Sun Valley area and head toward Highway 9 from GM and UPS. So there's opportunities there to expand on that side.
Land Street.
That's on the next that's five. And my new department is transportation, so I can tell you a little bit about that. The next, we are spending money, we are progressing, because the environmental studies and work that has to be done to meet federal guidelines, because that's all the national park is part of that, and wetlands and et cetera. And it's 3 to 5 years, 3 to 5 year process, but we're about at the end of that. And the next $5 million is design and right-of-way, and that is inching along. That T-SPLOST that was such a hot topic last year, was it last year or the year before? It seems like it was just yesterday. But that actually had the 400 interchange and the gateway on it. But there is little or no funding in Georgia DOT, and even less coming down the pike from the federal government. So we're just going to have to chip away at it as we can. But we're working on it. Thank you for having us.
Yeah, thank you.
We appreciate it.